Well, I've already told you what we're doing this evening, so let me just read for you the text we're going to be looking at, Genesis chapter 3, in verses, 1 through 19. Genesis 3, verses 1 through 19. And again, this describes for us the fall and the consequences of the fall. And let me just mention that even though I think we have talked recently or seen, actually, I think, yeah, Sproul was dealing with this issue in the Wednesday lecture we were looking at. The consequences of the fall, of course, being the curse upon the creation, making our work more difficult to subdue the creation. And also the difficulties in procreation, we're going to focus a little bit more on the greater consequence, which is hell. So let's read what it is that happened in Genesis 3, beginning in verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Indeed, has God said, 'You shall not eat from any tree of the garden?' The woman said to the serpent, 'From the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat. But from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, "You shall not eat from it or touch it, or you will die."' The serpent said to the woman, 'You surely will not die, for God knows that in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit and ate, and she gave also to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loin coverings." We can't deal with everything in this text, but let me just mention here again, the idea is not that Adam and Eve didn't know they weren't wearing clothes, but when they lost the Holy Spirit and they realized they had lost that original righteousness, they felt exposed to the judgment of God. And they felt the change, and that's what they're experiencing here, not the fact that they suddenly realize, hey, where'd my clothes go? You know, I thought I was clothed. No, that's not what happened. Okay, then verse 8. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" And the woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you more than all cattle, and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you will go, and dust you will eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel." To the woman he said, "I will greatly multiply your pain in childbirth. In pain you will bring forth children. Yet your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you." Then to Adam he said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree about which I commanded you, saying, 'You shall not eat from it,' cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you will eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall grow for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you will eat bread till you return to the ground, because from it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return." Again, there's a lot that's included in this text, but we're going to focus on the consequences of the fall and something about what's actually going on here with this serpent, to see that it's no mere serpent, obviously, that we're talking about here, but essentially Satan. Now, just again by way of introduction, this morning we noted, and I've already mentioned this, that we are a special creation of God, one of the two creatures that he made in his image, and again, the angels being the other. And what it means to be in the image of God is not that we look like him physically, because God doesn't have arms, he doesn't have eyes and ears. He speaks to us as though he does, but that we understand to be what we call anthropomorphic, which means that God is speaking to us in terms we can understand, in terms we can relate to. And what he does is similar to what we do in that regard. So again, we're not to think that our bodies are in the image of God. Rather, it's our soul that is in the image of God. He gave to us certain powers that the other creatures don't have. We have the power of thought, that we might think about him, that we might think his thoughts after him, that we might know him. He gave us his spirit so that we might love him and that we might love what he loves, again, so that we might have relation with him. And we know that he made us immortal. We will never die. One thing I forgot to mention is purpose as well. And when we're talking about purpose, what we mean by that is we have the ability to determine to do things, to make plans. And we also have the power to carry those plans out through this instrument the Lord has given to us, which we call the body. And as I've said, we are also like God in the sense that we will never ultimately cease to exist. We will die in certain ways, certain senses. As a matter of fact, the Lord told Adam, on the day that you eat from it, you shall surely die. But that's not what we're talking about. That is judicial death. That is death and punishment. It's physical death, but it's not the continuance of existence. Adam would still continue to exist, and so will we, because we are in the image of God. Now, as I've said, God made us this way so that we might have a relationship with him. God did not make us to be, as it were, a group of pets that he might take care of and enjoy. But he made us his children. He loves us, and he wants us to love him. And he's certainly given us every reason to love him. Now, God didn't make us because he needed a relationship. Remember, God doesn't need anything. He didn't need to make us to show us his glory. God already has everything he needs in himself. And because we know that God is triune, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, he already had fellowship, perfect fellowship, within himself. He didn't need to make a creature to have fellowship with us. He made us, rather, because he is good and he is gracious. Some have put it this way: God is essentially a full bucket. He is full of blessedness. He could not be any more happy or any more blessed than he is, but his bucket is full to overflowing, and he desires to show his goodness to others, so he made us that he might show us that kindness and that mercy and his love, that he might share that love with us. Now, that's one of the reasons why he made us, but he also made us that we might rule his creation under him, that we might govern the earth and its creatures in a way that pleases him, and that we might subdue the earth, make it yield up its potential for God's glory. And everything that we actually discover that we're able to use the earth for, and we've come a long way since the days of Adam and Eve. I mean, we have automobiles now, we have computers, we have all these different things. We are to do these things for his glory, to honor him and to praise him. But we also saw that since God created us, and that we are not a part of God, we're not made of divine material, divine substance, we don't believe in pantheism, that everything is God, we are different than God, we are below God, we are inferior, we are subservient to him, that means that we are also accountable to him. We are not God's equals. We are God's servants. We are God's stewards. And I just want to emphasize that because maybe you've heard, like I did many years ago, we visited a church when I was on vacation, heard a sermon where the pastor is talking about Jesus as his buddy. I hang out with Jesus. Jesus goes with me wherever I go. So he's my brother, he's my friend, he's my buddy. And he treats Jesus like a peer. That's not what Jesus is. He is our brother, but he's our elder brother. He's our friend. But friendship does not mean equality. It means we have somebody who cares about us and who is willing to give his life for us so that we might be saved. We do need to remember that he is the Lord, and it is our duty to serve him and to obey him. Our life does not belong to us. It belongs to him because he made us. Now, what I want us to see this evening is that we didn't do that. Even though we were his creatures, even though we owed him perfect obedience, we did not obey him. We still don't obey him as we ought, but now we're talking about the original sin that put us into this predicament. As we've just read, actually, we read in Genesis 2, 16 and 17, God gave us a test. The test was given in Adam, but Adam stood for all of us. We were all put to the test in him. And when he failed, when he fell, we all fell and became liable to God's judgment because we are guilty of the sin that he committed against God. We just read about the fact that he did fail in Genesis chapter 3. Now we need to understand that the fall, that man is fallen, that man is in the predicament that he is in, that we are in the predicament that we were in outside of Jesus, is foundational to the gospel. Gospel means good news, but it's good news with the backdrop of the bad news about what our situation was and what it is that would have happened to us. Good news wouldn't be good news unless there was a bad news or a bad situation that we were in that we needed to be saved from. And the fact that there is a fall means that there is something to be saved from. If there was no fall, if there was no guilt, if there was no curse upon us, if there was no corruption in our hearts, if there was no judgment that we had to face, then we wouldn't need a gospel. So the fall is integral. It is foundational to the gospel message. So tonight, let's just consider two things. It's, you know, the bad news, essentially. First of all, that we were put under a probation, but we fell. We failed. And then secondly, what our failure, what this fall did to us. So first of all, let's look at our probation and our fall. Now, probation, it means test. It means trial. In this case, a trial of obedience. If we were to read again in Genesis chapter 2, we would see that after God created us in his image, he put us in a beautiful garden to, first of all, to cultivate it, which means what it sounds like. Okay, we were supposed to till the garden. We were supposed to work the garden. Now, work is not the result of the fall. Sometimes we think that, you know, that Adam and Eve just basically didn't have to do anything in the garden. They could just relax and enjoy life, and that's the way things would have continued. But we do understand God gave mankind, gave us a task to do from the very beginning. Part of it was to cultivate this garden, which I think means perhaps the first stage, perhaps the beginning stage of subduing the earth, making the garden produce what it can produce to meet our needs and to give glory to God. Now, again, work isn't the result of the fall, but from what we've read in Genesis chapter 3, the fall made that work a lot more difficult. Most of the work we do today is to try to overcome the effects of the fall, whereas we could have been doing all this work without creation resisting us. Now we have to do it with creation fighting against us. R.C. Sproul mentioned in that study that that's one of the things we have to face in the world, is the curse on the world, that the world hates us because we put it under this curse, and so it resists us. It makes everything we do more difficult. But getting back now, okay, God put Adam and Eve into the garden to cultivate it. One thing we need to realize, though, about the garden is that this garden was obviously no ordinary garden. And it was more than just a perfect place of bliss and happiness and productivity. It also happened to be the temple of God. It happened to be the sanctuary of God, because at this time when God created the world, heaven and earth were essentially one. They were together. Heaven had not yet, as it were, separated from the earth and moved to another realm, which all we can say as far as where it is up. That's where Jesus went when he ascended into heaven, right? But at this time, it wasn't above, it was on the earth. And we know that because of what the Lord says through Ezekiel, speaking about Lucifer, in Ezekiel 28, verses 13 and 14. He says to him, and Lucifer remembers the one who fell and becomes Satan, becomes the devil. He says, "You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the ruby, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the lapis, the lazuli, the turquoise, and the emerald, and the gold. The workmanship of your settings and sockets was in you. On the day that you were created, they were prepared. You were the anointed cherub who covers, and I placed you there. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked in the midst of the stones of fire." Now notice what the Lord is saying through Ezekiel. He's saying that Lucifer was in Eden, and he was in Eden before he fell. He was on the mountain of God, so called because this is the mountain upon which God dwelt. So the mountain of God was in Eden, and Lucifer was there. Heaven was there. The angels were there with the Lord in Eden. Now we're going to come back to this passage again in just a moment, because we're going to understand a bit more about Lucifer's getting into the garden. How did the serpent, how did this happen? Now, because the garden was God's sanctuary, we, as mankind, were also given a very special task, and that was to be the guardians or the custodians of the garden. We read in Genesis 2:15, "Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and keep it." I think sometimes we think of the word keep as tending, and in a certain sense it is tending, but the word keep means we were put there to keep watch or to guard this garden. Essentially, we were to be like the temple guard. Remember in Israel where they had the temple of God, there was a special guard that was set up in order to protect the holiness of God from those who would intrude on his holiness. They were not allowed to let anyone in who was unclean or unauthorized to come into the presence of God. They were to guard and protect the holiness of God. So our job in the garden was to keep the intruders out. But of course, there was more than that. There was also the test. A test that has been, as we look at what exactly was going on in this particular test, we understand that it was really a trial to see whether or not Adam and Eve would obey God purely by his word. It was a test of pure obedience. God said that we could eat any of the trees in the garden. We could have all of them out of his kindness and his grace, but not from one particular tree. And we might ask the question, why? Well, for no other reason than God said, "Don't eat of this tree," to see whether or not we would obey him purely on the basis of his word. By the way, I think there's a good application of this for today, which is often we don't understand why the Lord calls us to do certain things, why he says certain things are wrong. We shouldn't do this. We shouldn't behave this way. We shouldn't pursue these particular relationships. And maybe we don't always understand why the Lord forbids those things, but we do know that whatever he forbids or whatever he commands is always good, even if we don't understand it. So we need to do it simply because God says. And I think if we study it long enough, we'll see there's always a good reason for what the Lord commands. Now, we know what happened. God allowed an intruder to enter into the garden, Lucifer, who was actually already in the garden. Remember, he was on the holy mountain of God, as we saw earlier. But by this time, he had become something other than what God had created him to be. He had become Satan or the devil. And I think what happened to him is essentially what happens to man when he sins against God, which is the Holy Spirit withdraws and left him purely evil. He had been thrown out of God's presence because of the unrighteousness, his desire to exalt himself above God. We read in Ezekiel 28, again, verses 15 and 16 now, "Regarding Lucifer, you were blameless in your ways from the day you were created until unrighteousness was found in you. By the abundance of your trade, you were internally filled with violence and you sinned. Therefore, I have cast you as profane from the mountain of God, and I have destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire." So Satan was in the presence of God. He was God's greatest creation and beautiful with all the decorations we read about earlier and in his wisdom and his beauty. And yet, because of that, he became prideful and thought perhaps he was better than God. And when the sin was seen in him, and we know from the book of Revelation there was a rebellion in heaven, that he led a rebellion against God, a third of the angels followed, and they all fell, and they were all cast out of heaven. But the point is this: once he was cast out, his first inclination was to destroy those that he was actually created to serve, and that is us. Remember this morning we saw the angels were created greater in power because they were made to be servants of those who will inherit salvation. Now, Jonathan Edwards believes that when that was revealed to the angels, remember that Adam and Eve were not in the garden for very long, which means that during the creation week, the angels were created earlier in the week, Adam and Eve later in the week. The fall took place after the creation week, but probably within the first few weeks of their being in the garden, that the occasion, the reason why the rebellion took place was because the angels then began to understand why they were created, that in all their power, and you might say superiority to us, it was revealed to them by God that they would serve us, those of us, you know, again, who were tending the garden, as it were. And Satan could not accept that. And so his pride overcame him, and the angels who followed him. So he was cast out, and his first inclination was to destroy those he was created to serve, to destroy us. Now, being a spirit, he disguised himself by possessing a serpent. We know this was no ordinary serpent. And when God put that curse upon the serpent, he didn't curse snakes. He didn't pull, some say that serpents actually had legs, and God pulled the legs off of it and made it crawl in the dust and so forth from that point on. I don't think that that's what happened, but what he did was he was pronouncing a curse on Satan. And he was talking about Satan's demise in the end when he would send Jesus into the world to crush his head. But he disguised himself by possessing a serpent. He went to the forbidden tree. He tempted us to break God's commandment. Now, being the guardians of the garden, it was our job to repel the intruder, to send him away, but instead we listened to him. And we fell away from God. We failed the probation. We listened to the serpent rather than listening to God. And that's the predicament the people of the world are in. It's what Paul talks about in Ephesians chapter 2. And what we used to do before we came to Christ, we were walking according to the prince of the power of the air, like the rest of the world, following Satan and doing what he would do. And that's really the situation the fall brought us into. So that's what we want to look at second. What did the fall do to us? Well, the first thing it didn't do is it didn't entirely destroy God's image. We are still in the image of God, but we lost a very important part of that image. The part that makes us love him. The part that makes us desire everything that's good. Last week, we were looking at the attributes of God. And we noted that they can be divided into two different categories. His natural attributes and his moral attributes. And we talk about man being made in the likeness of God. We share similarities in both of these categories. Now, God's natural attributes have to do with his power. They have to do with his limitless presence, remember, his timelessness, his almighty power to do all that he wants to do, his comprehensive knowledge of everything that's going to happen and everything that could happen under any given circumstances. But there's also his moral attributes that have to do with his holiness, his love, his grace, his mercy, his justice, his goodness, and his truth. Now, we need to understand how important those moral qualities, attributes are in God. They're much more important than I think we realize. I mean, think of what it would be like to live in a world created by a being who is everywhere present, all the time, the power to do whatever he wants to do, who knows our every thought, knows everything that we might do, but who was evil and unmerciful. You know, I mean, it would be the greatest conceivable nightmare to live in such a world. There could be no possible hiding from God, no escape from what he might desire to do to us. We would be helpless. Thankfully, that isn't the case. God is holy. His holiness is what makes him to be the beautiful God that he is. Well, as I've said, like God, we also have two kinds of attributes. We share something of the likeness of his natural attributes, not all of them, but some of them, and his moral attributes or his moral image. Now, even though we're fallen, we still have those natural components, those natural attributes. We can still think. We can still plan and carry out our plans. We're still going to live forever. Those things are still true of us. And that's why the Bible still represents mankind as made in the image of God, still in the image of God. As a matter of fact, that is the basis of capital punishment. I mean, why is it that if we kill somebody, that our life is forfeit? It's not because it'll bring that person back, but it's because it's just. If we take away someone's life, our life should also be taken away. But it's also because of the crime that we've committed, which is destroying the image of God, because that's what man is. God says in Genesis 9:6, whoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed, for in the image of God he made man. That's the reason why it's such a terrible crime to take away life, is because we are in the image of God. Now, James points to this fact as well when he warns us against the misuse of our tongue and how serious it is to use it against those who were made in the image of God. He says in James 3, verses 7 through 9, for every species of beasts and birds, of reptiles and creatures of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by the human race. But no one can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil and full of deadly poison. With it, we bless our Lord and Father, and with it, we curse men who have been made in the likeness of God. So the point is, we didn't lose all of the attributes. We didn't lose the natural attributes, but we did lose something that was very precious, what it is that made us good. Again, strip away God's holiness, and what do you have? You have an evil God. Strip away our holiness. Strip away our love for him. Strip away our love for what's good. Take away what's called our original righteousness, the origin of all the good things we want to do, the source of all of our good works. That's what we lost. We lost the moral image of God. We essentially lost the Holy Spirit. Remember what happened when Lucifer lost the Holy Spirit and what he became? The same thing happened to us. So we are still in the image of God. We still have his natural attributes. But we are no longer in the likeness of his moral image. We are still moral creatures, but we're morally corrupt. We no longer love God, now we hate God. We no longer love his law, now we hate his law. Paul writes in Romans 8, verses 7 through 8, and what he's talking about here is the condition in which we came into the world, talking about what it's like to be in the flesh. He says, the mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God, for it does not subject itself to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so, and those who are in the flesh cannot please God. So what is the disposition of the heart of the fallen man towards God? He's hostile toward God. And he will not subject himself to the law of God. He can't, because his heart is steeled against God. He no longer wants to do what is good. Now he writes, again, Paul writes in Romans 3, verses 10 through 12, and this is a commentary on fallen mankind. There is none righteous, not even one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become useless. There is none who does good. There is not even one. So essentially what this means is, not only do we hate God and refuse to submit to him. But even if the Lord offers to help us, which he does through the gospel, we don't want his help. Jesus tells us in John 6:63 that the flesh profits nothing. And we already read in Romans chapter 8 how those who are in the flesh are hostile toward God. Those who hate God aren't going to come to God in order to be saved by his Savior. That's the predicament that we're in. That's what it means to lose the moral image of God. Now, we not only lost our original righteousness, lost the Holy Spirit, and became corrupt within, we also became guilty. When Adam sinned, we sinned. Now, we're not guilty of all of Adam's sins, but we are guilty of that one sin of rebellion against God. Because he was our representative, God charged that crime to us. God looks at us as though we committed that sin, because now with that imputation of that sin to us, we actually did commit that sin in Adam. And that's why Paul writes in Romans 5:12, "So then, as through one transgression," that's the failure at the tree, "there resulted condemnation," therefore, as through one man," back to Romans 5:12, "therefore, just as through one man, sin entered into the world, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned." We all sinned when Adam sinned. And then getting back to verses 18 and 19, "So then, as through one transgression there resulted condemnation to all men, even so through one act of righteousness there resulted justification of life to all men. For as through the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, even so through the obedience of the one the many will be made righteous." Now, think about this for a minute. Just from these verses, okay, God imputes Adam's sin to us. And so we stand before God guilty because of what Adam did. When he sinned, we all sinned. We all died. We all became guilty. We're all under condemnation. Now, if we object to the idea of imputation, having somebody else's guilt reckoned to us, credited to us, obviously, we need to realize that we cannot be saved apart from imputation. We need imputation because we are saved by the imputation of our sins to Jesus. Our sins were laid on him on the cross. He didn't commit those sins, but he died in our place for those sins. His righteousness was imputed to us when we trusted in him. We didn't obey the Lord. He did. But yet we get his righteousness. So yes, we might object to the idea that Adam's sin was imputed to us, but we need to realize that imputation works two ways. It condemns us, but it also saves us if we're trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. And God is absolutely righteous in this principle of imputation. One may take the place of the other. We do that all the time in life. We have representatives we vote for, people we hire to do things for us, and we become responsible for them. So representation is a part of our lives. We know it is. There's nothing wrong with it. That's the way the Lord put us on trial. And that is the way he also saved us. Now, this imputation or this crediting of Adam's guilt to us is the reason why when we're conceived in our mother's womb and become part of the human race at that moment of conception, that we are already guilty. David writes in Psalm 51, verse 5, "Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me." The reason why we're guilty is because of Adam's sin. That's the reason why David was guilty. But we're guilty for another reason, which we often don't think about. And that is because of the disposition of our hearts. Because we hated God when we came into this world. Remember, Jesus tells us in the Sermon on the Mount that the commandments are not only broken through our actions, but they're also broken in our hearts. If we have the desire to do something that is wrong, we're still breaking the commandment. Even though it may not be as severe, it's still breaking the commandment. For instance, just as Jesus says in Matthew 5, verses 21 through 22, "You have heard the ancients were told, 'You shall not commit murder, and whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court.' But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court." He didn't kill his brother, but he was angry with his brother and wanted to harm him. He is also guilty. So if being angry with a brother or sister makes us guilty before the court in a similar way as having committed murder, then what does hating God deserve? You see, that's the disposition of our souls as we come into the world as soon as we are conceived. We have the guilt of Adam's first sin, and we have the disposition of his heart that he had after he sinned, which is the hatred of God, and that makes us guilty as well. But then being guilty, and here's the final point, we are also under God's judgment. Remember what God told Adam in Genesis 2:17. In the day that you eat from it, from that tree, you will surely die. Paul writes in Romans 6:23, we talk about the Romans road to salvation. We often share this passage. The wages of sin is death. And we know that what God was speaking of and what Paul was writing about was not merely physical death. They were talking about eternal death and destruction. Now that was our danger. We were guilty before a holy and righteous God who is going to hold us accountable, not just for the one sin of Adam and not just for the hatred of our heart against him, but every way in which that hatred has actually expressed itself since we've come into the world, every single sin we have ever committed. We are going to be held accountable by a God who knows absolutely everything we have done. Jesus said, even every idle word that we speak will be brought up in the day of judgment. That is, if we're not trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. The judge will also know every mitigating or aggravating circumstance, and he will weigh everything in the balance and then punish us accordingly. But everyone who has any sin that is on their account is going to have to endure hell and endure it forever. Now, Paul writes this in Romans 2, verses 4 through 8. Or do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repentance? But because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to each person according to his deeds. To those who by perseverance in doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. But to those who are selfishly ambitious and do not obey the truth but obey unrighteousness, wrath and indignation. Now again, that's the judgment that we were under. The judgment of this wrath, this condemnation that we would have experienced in hell. Now, what makes it even worse is the fact that this punishment would have gone on forever. John writes in Revelation 14:11, and the smoke of their torment goes up forever and ever. And the reason why hell goes on forever is because the sins that we commit are not just against one another, but they are against an infinitely holy and worthy God. And the only way we could ever satisfy for that would be to suffer forever, because we could never satisfy for the crimes that we have committed against him. Forever is a very long time. Thomas Watson has a couple of interesting quotes here that I think will help us at least to grasp what we can in a very brief period of time. How, you know, just the idea of hell is bad enough, but to know that it stretches on endlessly, forever, that one never comes out of hell, makes it unbearable, obviously, even more unbearable. So this is what Thomas Watson writes. First, he says this: the torments of hell abide forever. If all the earth and sea were sand, if this was just a big ball of sand, the earth, and every thousandth year a bird should come and take away one grain of the sand, it would be a long time ere that vast heap of sand were emptied. Yet, if after all that time the damned may come out of hell, there were some hope. There would be some hope. But this word ever breaks the heart. There is never coming out of hell. It goes on forever. And then he also says this, Thus it is in hell. They would die, but they cannot. The wicked shall be always dying, but never dead. The smoke of the furnace ascends forever and ever. Oh, who can endure thus to be ever upon the rack? This word ever breaks the heart. Wicked men now think the Sabbath's long and think a prayer long. But oh, how long will it be to lie in hell forever and ever? Now this, again, is what the Bible said we were looking forward to when we came into this world. And every sin that we have committed since we have come into the world will only aggravate this punishment and make it worse, or it would have, if not for the Father's grace in giving us His Son. So the fall of man and the consequences of the fall are why we need the gospel. And I think unless somebody understands the danger and predicament that they're in, they're never going to see their need for the Savior. They need to know. Now, we can tell them, and we need to tell them, but the Spirit of God needs to bring home and help them to understand and to show them the dire consequences or straits that they're in so that they might turn to the Lord. Now, next week, we're going to look at the fourth foundational principle in the series of the fundamentals of the gospel. Again, the Bible, the Word of God. God is triune and what He's like. We saw that. This is the third one, the fall and the consequences of the fall. Next week, we're going to look at what the Father did to save all who will come to His Son, what He did to save them through the work of Jesus Christ, through His obedience and His death on the cross. Again, so bear in mind the bad news, because it makes the good news look all the much better. Well, let's bow, shall we, for a moment of prayer, and let's just ask the Lord to take what we've heard and apply it.